This year marks the 100th anniversary of the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory Fire that occurred on March 25th, 1911. Thank you. So I'm reading to you from an article written by a senior public health correspondent, and he writes, "Screams of 'don't jump' echoed through the canyons of tall buildings. More than 50 bodies littered the streets surrounding 23 Washington Place, so many that New York City's fire trucks were unable to get close enough to raise their ladders. Even if they had, the ladders from nearby Company 20 were too short to reach the 8th, 9th, and 10th floors of the burning Triangle Shirtwaist Factory. New York Fire Department reports say the flames, which were probably sparked by a cigarette tossed into a pile of cotton scraps on the 8th floor, rapidly spread to the floors above. The maelstrom of fire was knocked down in 18 minutes, brief but long enough to snuff out the lives of 146 workers who were just minutes from heading home from their 52-hour work week that sunny Saturday afternoon. The victims of that inferno 100 years ago were almost all new immigrants, mostly women and girls, Italians, Russians, Hungarians, and Germans. Few spoke English. The youngest victim was 11, according to the death reports. Most were in their teens, and a few were in their early 20s. These were 500 seamstresses and tailors working in this factory. Many on the 8th and 10th floors escaped. Few on the 9th floor had much chance of surviving. Some stood on the narrow window ledges, alone or clutching friends, waiting for rescue that never came, then jumped or lost their balance and fell to their deaths. The height of the fall was so great that the jumpers tore through the safety nets that a circle of firefighters were frantically moving up and down the street to try to catch them. The 146 lives lost in the fire ignited a passion for worker safety laws and indirectly led to the creation of the Occupational Safety and Health Administration, OSHA. Yet a century later, the laws that could have saved lives then, had they been in place, are being threatened by budget cuts proposed by Congress. Great irony is that all of this attempt to dismantle health and safety regulations is occurring precisely 100 years to date from that fire. The U.S. has made progress in worker protection, and yet out of 30 nations, the U.S. is ranked 29th in industrial nations for safety and health protection for workers, managing just barely to beat out Turkey. So the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory Fire remained for almost 100 years the most deadly industrial accident in New York City until September 11th, 2001. Those of you who know me know that I usually include scripture whenever I preach, because I'm on a one-woman campaign to recover our sacred writings from their use and abuse, and I believe they remain terribly wonderfully powerful. So what I want to do is I want to invite you to listen to the first lesson from Exodus as if you are an African who has been brought to this country against your will and reduced to slavery, but in order to appease your master's guilt, you are being Christianized and baptized and exposed to the Bible, the scriptures. So from Exodus 1 and Exodus 2. "Now a new king arose from Egypt. He said to his people, 'Look, the Israelite people are more numerous and more powerful than we. Come, let us deal shrewdly with them, or they will increase, and in the event of war, join our enemies and fight against us and escape from the land. Therefore, they set taskmasters over them to oppress them with forced labor. They built supply cities, Pithom and Rasmuses, for Pharaoh. But the more they were oppressed, the more they multiplied and spread, so that the Egyptians came to dread the Israelites. The Egyptians became ruthless in imposing tasks on the Israelites and made their lives bitter with harsh service in mortar and brick and in every field of labor. They were ruthless in all the tasks that they imposed on them. And the Israelites groaned under their slavery, and their cries for help rose up to God. God heard their groaning, and God remembered his covenant with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And God looked upon the Israelites, and God took notice of them. And now for this next reading from the Gospel according to St. Matthew, I want you to imagine for a moment that you are a member of a union, perhaps Verizon, or perhaps Christus St. Vincent Nurses Union, and you are hearing this scripture reading from Matthew, which is actually the words of Jesus. And I will simply change and update some of the language so it's appropriate. So I'm going to change the word church to community. If another member of the community sins against you, go and point out the fault when the two of you are alone. If the member listens to you, you have regained that one. But if you are not listened to, take one or two others along with you so that every word may be confirmed by the evidence of two or three witnesses. If the member refuses to listen to them, tell it to the community, and if the offender refuses to listen to the community, let each a one be to you as an outcast. Truly, I tell you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Again, truly I tell you, if two of you agree on earth about anything you ask, it will be done for you by our Creator in heaven. For where two or three are gathered in the name of justice and compassion, I am there among them. Now, if this is not a mandate for collective bargaining, I don't know what is. And then the reading from James, you can listen to it any way you want to. Listen, he says, the wages of the laborers who mowed our fields, which you kept back by fraud, cry out. And the cries of the harvesters have reached the ears of the Lord of hosts. Thus ends the readings. In the richest country in the world, millions of full-time, year-round workers live below the poverty line, struggling to pay for necessities such as food, housing, health care, transportation, and childcare. And that's a direct quote from the Interfaith Worker Justice website. The American dream that my immigrant Republican parents attained, thanks to the New Deal, is slipping away as more and more middle-class families find it impossible to make ends meet with one paycheck. For low-wage workers, two paychecks may not be adequate. I have a vivid memory of a town hall meeting in Omaha, Nebraska in 2005 when a divorced mother of three stood up tearfully to tell then President George W. Bush that she was holding down three jobs in order to support herself and her children. And that left very little time for her family. President Bush replied, "You work three jobs." Uniquely American, isn't it? I mean, it's fantastic that you're doing that. Does anybody else remember that? Yeah. Yeah, it's something you don't forget. Uniquely American since when? We may not agree on the causes or solutions, but we know that this nation faces some serious problems. And as Martin Luther King Jr. reminds us, the ultimate measure of a people is not where we stand in moments of comfort and convenience, but where we stand at a time of challenge and controversy. We are living in those times. So as people of faith and conscience, we may turn to our sacred writings for wisdom and guidance. And if those sacred writings are in the Bible, both the Hebrew Scriptures and the New Testament, we find that they are full, absolutely replete with stories, teachings, psalms, prophets, and laws about how we are to conduct our financial affairs as individuals, businesses, and governments. According to noted Old Testament scholar and theologian Walter Brueggemann, every strand of biblical faith shows God to be deeply engaged and passionately concerned for economic issues. Contrary to much popular religion, God of the Bible cares a great deal about debts and mortgages, interest, workers and wages, and is preoccupied with the well-being of the poor. Let me explain by posing a question. If I were to ask you to list your favorite story in the Old Testament, you might name, I don't know, Noah's Ark, Jonah and the whale, David and Goliath, Daniel and the lion's den, assuming, of course, that you've been taught these stories by your parents or your grandparents or a faith community. However, if I asked you which story in the Old Testament is the most important, your answer might change. Now, if you were raised in a somewhat conservative Christian tradition, you might be inclined to point to Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. But that's only because St. Augustine succeeded in distracting the early church fathers with his personal obsessions. If you were raised in a Jewish family, the answer would be quite easy, the story of Exodus, because every year your family would gather around the Seder table to celebrate Passover and retell the story of the Hebrew people with stories and songs and prayers. Remembering is important to Jews from the pre-biblical days to the present. On Passover, they don't just remember what happened to those ancient people way back there in that distant, far-off land. They remember what happened to when we were strangers in Egypt, and God heard our cries and freed us from oppression under Pharaoh in Egypt and led us to the promised land. So the message of Passover is this: no matter how well off or how difficult your lives may be, God is with us now, just as God was with us in Egypt. Remembering is, in fact, important to all faith traditions. This is how we pass on to the next generation the wisdom that we have acquired, so that our children and our children's children can learn from their forebears and hopefully avoid repeating the same mistakes. Those who forget their history or ignore their history are doomed to repeat it. One is ignorant, the other is arrogant. Walter Brueggemann agrees on both counts. He writes, "The central and defining narrative of biblical faith is the story of Exodus, and while popular religion is preoccupied with the parting of the Red Sea, in fact, this defining memory is not about water. It is about rescue from economic disaster, unbearable poverty, slave labor, and the wonder of God's powerful and preferential love for the poor, downtrodden, and oppressed of the world." That rescue, according to Brueggemann, was not accomplished by an easy sweep of a divine hand. It required tedious, nerve-wracking negotiations led by Moses, and, this is my spin, a prolonged strike that lasted through 10 plagues. This emancipation of the working poor, who became the nation of Israel, is accomplished by an inspired team that refused to accept degrading poverty and economic injustice as a permanent and legitimate social condition. Rabbi Dina Feingold, who serves a congregation in Madison, Wisconsin, led the prayer services in the rotunda this past winter to protest the union-busting tactics of Governor Scott Walker, one of the new generation of pharaohs who's effectively stripping workers' rights and cutting state budgets to the bone to pay for corporate tax cuts. This fall in Wisconsin, public schools throughout the rural area will be closed, and students of all ages will be required to take pre-dawn bus rides to the nearest school, no doubt passing a few private academies that their parents cannot afford. Rabbi Feingold writes, "It is no coincidence that faith communities are lining up on one side of this issue." She continues, "Our traditions since the time of enslavement in Egypt have always sided with the poor, the powerless, and the disenfranchised, and have taught us to speak out when we see injustice." At rallies and marches and vigils across the country, protesters are showing up dressed in pharaoh masks and costumes, as the obvious comparison sweeps through faith communities. Now, once the Israelites were released from slavery, they began to learn what it means to live together as a free people. And one of the very first commandments that was given to them at Mount Sinai was the commandment to observe the Sabbath, a guaranteed day of rest every single week for everybody, including the beasts of burden that pulled their carts and plowed their fields. Now, the idea of a day of rest for the working class was unprecedented in the ancient world. But there are other laws that are found in the Hebrew Scriptures. In the book of Deuteronomy, it is announced that the year of Jubilee, every sixth year, after every 6 years, no matter how great the debt, it must be canceled and forgiven. In Deuteronomy 8 through 10, it says, "Not only must you cancel their debts and let the debtor free, you must provide liberally extra resources to the poor so they can be economically viable, and thus you eliminate poverty from your community. And to those who have prospered, they are instructed, remember, you shall not wrong a stranger or oppress him, for you were strangers in the land of Egypt. You shall not abuse any widow or orphan. If you do abuse them, when they cry out to me, I will surely heed their cry, and my wrath will burn." I always like it when God's wrath is directed away from me rather than toward me. Now, some might scoff at the idea of trying to apply these ancient laws to our complex post-industrial, global, and capitalistic economy, but the fundamental moral, ethical, and theological principles remain the same. IWJ has a slogan that we affix to buttons and banners and handouts. It's very simple and it's very true. All religions believe in justice. IWJ believes that the sacred link between faith and labor is as relevant today as it was when Moses, Jesus, and Mohammed first taught us that God has a preferential concern for the poor, the powerless, and the disenfranchised. And God calls us to use our collective power to work for justice and compassion. Now, throughout history, people of faith and conscience have done a pretty good job of defending workers' rights with a few notable lapses. During the age of the robber barons, sermons could be heard from those wealthy, powerful steeple churches, preaching that unions and the labor movement were challenging God's created order, and they would quote scripture like 1 Samuel, "The Lord makes poor and the Lord makes rich, the Lord brings low and the Lord exalts." Don't mess with God's created order. And that disparity continues today. Most distressing is the rise of megachurches that preach prosperity theology. This has been particularly harmful in the historic black churches that were for generations the one place that African Americans could hear liberation theology preached. It's enough to cause some of us to stick our fingers in our ears, hum out loud, and run. So we may prefer to abandon our religious traditions and sacred writings, but the opposition is using these writings as a powerful resource against us. The late William Sloan Coffin, who was the former pastor of Riverside Church in Manhattan and the chaplain at Yale Divinity School, used to hold public debates with Jerry Falwell back in the 80s when no one else would dare. Falwell was just too good at proof texting his arguments with chapter and verse. People less skilled were just too intimidated. And then Coffin blew his cover. He found that as often as Falwell was correct about chapter and verse, he was also wrong. But no one caught it because he was too quick, too sure of himself, and everybody else was just too ignorant. Coffin took him on because he explained, if we remain silent, we let them co-opt our sacred writings. We lose not only the debate, but the moral and theological credibility in the eyes of those who are watching and listening. Karen Armstrong, the noted writer, once said that a people who don't understand the religious traditions that shaped their history and their culture can never truly understand their history and their culture. But it's not just our religious traditions that we're forgetting. I fear we have forgotten our history as Americans. We have forgotten that this nation was built on the back of workers, including slaves brought here against their will, indentured servants, factory and immigrant workers, sharecroppers and tenant farmers who did the backbreaking work and turned the profits over to landed gentry and business owners. This past March, the same month as the 100th anniversary of the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory Fire, Governor LePage of Maine removed a historic mural from the Labor Department headquarters in Augusta. The 11-panel mural includes images of worker strikes and Rosie the Riveter. It was moved into a storage facility where it will be kept, according to the governor's staff, until it can be transferred to a more appropriate venue. Have we forgotten that labor is a vital part of the fabric of this nation? Perhaps because the history of the labor movement is no longer taught in public schools, and labor reports that used to be almost a daily occurrence on the radio and in print have virtually vanished. There's a wonderful website out there called Digital History. It reminds us that the legacy of slavery, which has so profoundly affected our society and culture, is still being revealed. Slaves not only built the South, they also created the wealth of the North. Next time you visit Washington, D.C., gaze up at the bronze statue perched on the top of the dome. It's called Freedom. And yet few admiring visitors know that 12 slaves not only cast the statue, but also devised a method for hoisting it up to its present pinnacle. Nor do most visitors know that some 400 slaves also built the Capitol building and the White House as well. And there are records. There are records that are held in the archives of the Treasury Department that bear the names of plantation owners who were paid 5 $1,000 a month wages for his slaves that did the work. In 1862, Congress authorized the most ambitious project the country had ever contemplated, the construction of the Transcontinental Railroad. 1,800 miles across arid plains, desert, and the rugged granite walls of the Sierra Nevada Rocky Mountains. But the project faced an acute labor shortage, so the Central Pacific decided to try a new labor pool. Chinese immigrants, arguing that people who built the Great China Wall certainly could build a railroad. Due to civil turmoil and poverty, immigrants were coming from China to California. And by 1852, there were about 25,000 living in California, and the overwhelming majority were married men who planned to return to their homes. And they found work in agriculture, mines, domestic service, and increasingly in railroad construction. Does any of this have an eerie familiarity to you? They received $26 to $35 a month for 12-hour days, 6 days a week, and had to provide their own food and tents. White workers, on the other hand, received $35 a month and were furnished food and shelter. The work was grueling, performed almost entirely by hand. Dirt and rocks were carried away in baskets and carts. Tree stumps had to be rooted out, tracks laid, spikes driven, and aqueducts created. And to carve out a rail trail from ridges that jutted 2,000 feet over the valley below, Chinese immigrants were lowered in baskets to hammer at solid shale and granite and insert dynamite. And during the winter of 1865, when the railroad carved passages through the summit of the Sierra Nevadas, 3,000 lived and worked in tunnels dug beneath 40 feet of snow. Accidents, avalanches, and explosions cost the lives of half of those Chinese immigrant workers. And yet, despite their labor, Chinese immigrants became the objects of discriminatory laws and racial violence. California banned them from appearing as witnesses in court, prohibited them from voting or for becoming naturalized citizens, and placed their children in segregated schools. We may forget that the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory was one of many deplorable sweatshops in the United States that exploited immigrants and children. In the early 1800s, in this country, children ages 7 to 12 made up one-third of the workforce in the United States factories. By the mid-1850s, several states had adopted laws regulating the hours children under the age of 12 could work. That would be 10 hours a day. Nevertheless, child labor continued to be profitable, and by the turn of the 19th century, one-fifth of all children ages 10 through 16 in this country were working 10 hours, 6 to 7 days a week. This nation was built on the back of workers. Indentured servants, slave and child laborers, tenant farmers, sharecroppers, sweatshop and factory workers, and of course, immigrants. And they continue to be simultaneously exploited and persecuted today on our watch. Immigrant reform is the civil rights issue of our age. Cesar Chavez, the founder of the Farm Workers Union, you remember the grape and lettuce boycotts? He once said, "It's ironic that those who till the soil, cultivate and harvest the fruits, vegetables, and other foods that fill our tables with abundance, have nothing left for themselves." So we remember this appalling history of abuse and exploitation of laborers, and we remember that it was all quite legal, supported by the laws of the day, and in large part condoned or ignored by the general public. Reverend Peter Morales, who I heard preach down at First UU, and his sermon, which I highly recommend, is online, you can find it, reminds us that as citizens, we should respect the rule of law. But the fact that something is legal does not cut much ethical ice. Have we forgotten that the powerful have always used the legal system to oppress the powerless? Our duty is to create laws that are founded on our highest sense of justice, equity, and compassion. And yet we hear this argument, end quote, and yet we hear this argument being made here in New Mexico as justification for revoking driver's licenses for undocumented immigrants, some 80,000 men and women who have met all the requirements, abide by the law, support the local economy, and now are under attack by this governor who has decided that a law that was passed in 2003 and seemed to be working fine, thank you, 2003, which was 2 years after September 11th, has not been an issue for the state legislature in any session since 2003, is suddenly, 8 years later, a huge threat to our national security. And too often I have heard reasoned, ethical people agree with her on the grounds that these immigrants are breaking the law. Peter Morales says, "Here I must speak about the issue of some people being legal and others being illegal. Oh, it is easy to determine who has a legal right to be here, but what about the moral right? As religious and ethical people who affirm human compassion, who advocate for human rights, who seek justice, we must never, never make the mistake of confusing a legal right with a moral right." End quote. Labor Day is a few weeks away. It's the secular holy day that has lost its historic significance and been reduced to a 3-day weekend that marks the symbolic end of summer. The first Labor Day was in 1878 in Boston, Massachusetts, and it became a federal holiday in 1894. It was created to commemorate and celebrate the historic struggle for workers' rights that we take for granted, including the hourly minimum wage, the 8-hour workday, the 5-day work week that gave us weekends, child labor laws that not only protect children, but made it possible for them to go to school and get an education. Anti-discrimination laws that protect minorities and women, health and safety regulations, maternity leave, paid sick leave, paid holidays and vacations, pensions and health care. All of these rights and benefits were fought for and won by the labor movement through collective bargaining. And many of these rights and benefits are slipping away. Wage theft is a national epidemic and a serious problem in New Mexico. And that's the issue we're addressing here in Santa Fe. Labor unions have been under attack in this country for decades. Membership peaked in 1953 and experienced a massive decline between 79 and 83. Union busting has become so widespread here in the United States that Human Rights Watch, did a full study and released a report. Our right to collective bargaining has reached the crisis point. As unions decline, so does our national standard of living, and the disparity between the rich and the poor skyrockets. During the 50s, when this nation was experiencing its greatest economic prosperity, General Motors was the largest employer in the nation. Unionized General Motors. The standard of living attained through collective bargaining that allowed my Republican parents to raise 3 children and send them all to college and eventually retire in comfort, all on one paycheck, that American dream is slipping away. Today, the largest employer in the United States is low-wage, union-busting Walmart, whose workers turn to community charities to subsidize their take-home paychecks. Bill Moyers once said, "Charity provides crumbs from the table. Justice offers a place at the table." And Ralph Nader said, "The more a society has justice, the less that society needs charity." The decline in strong labor unions has had a negative impact on all our workers, and it's allowed our minimum wage to lag far behind the cost of living. After a 10-year stagnation from 97 to 2007, the longest in our history, the minimum wage was raised by the federal government from $5.15 an hour to now $7.25. We raised it here in New Mexico prior to the federal government, and we raised it to $7.50. And we sent a message to the Congress that said, "This isn't possible, watch us, and then come home and explain to us why you can't fix it in Congress." So even at $7.25, that's way behind the minimum wage peak value in 1968, which was the equivalent of $10.04 an hour. A study by the Center for Economic and Policy Research found that in a long list of 95 nations that includes the Dominican Republic and Vietnam, the United States is the only nation that does not guarantee its workers a single day of paid vacation. Paid sick leave is also a concern. So one in four U.S. workers does not receive a single day of paid vacation or paid holidays. And without it, workers are at a risk, such as that working mother of three in Omaha, Nebraska. And it's particularly hard when people don't have sick leave and are at risk of losing their jobs if they or a child gets sick and they have to stay home. So if your employer gives you 2 weeks paid vacation per year, you have the unions to thank, because it was the unions who fought to make that the competitive standard in the United States, not our government. In Australia, since you're all miserable already, in Australia in 2011, the minimum wage is $13.39 an hour, and paid vacations start at a mandated 4 weeks per year. Now, I have not heard much economic stress out of Australia as a result of these workers' rights. Unions, like every human institution, including religion, government, families, and marriage, are subject to chaos, dysfunction, and corruption. They are also essential for protecting workers' rights, negotiating fair wages, benefits, and ensuring safe working conditions. More important, we can thank unions for creating and sustaining the middle class. And without a middle class, democracy is in serious trouble. No wonder union busting is at the top of the list for these new pharaohs in states like Wisconsin and Ohio and New Jersey and Florida and Maine. And here in New Mexico, we face the same challenges that our brothers and sisters are facing elsewhere. Make no mistake about it, we need to stand together with just as much determination and resolve. From the Israelites held in bondage under Pharaoh in Egypt, God's people have been subjected to cruel and demeaning working conditions. Or as Abraham Lincoln put it, "There has never been but one question in all civilization: how to keep a few men from saying to many men, 'You work and earn bread, and we will eat it.'" From the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory workers in New York City to child laborers in textile mills of New England, from coal miners in Appalachia to the uranium miners in New Mexico, from farm workers in California to ranch hands in Clovis, from stockyards in Amarillo to the slaughterhouses in Chicago, from the hospitality workers in Santa Fe to the sanitation workers in Albuquerque, from the oil riggers in the Gulf of Mexico to the liquidators at Chernobyl and more recently Fukushima, and the firefighters who risked their lives and their health to put out those wildfires here in our state, we must remember and reaffirm our call to keep faith with America's workers and protect America's dream.